Greetings, students, and welcome to the special domestic edition of The Professor Travel. I am your host, The Professor Travel, coming to you from Orange County, California. This is the website, the blog, and the podcast that you come to in order to learn more about different travel destinations. This is where you go to discuss them as a community. Hopefully, this will inspire you to travel more and enjoy life more. Now, you can reach me on a variety of social media platforms, including my website, which is at theprofessortravel.com. I am also available on both YouTube and Facebook at The Professor Travel. I'm now available on TikTok, if you have anybody else out there who does that, at The Professor Travel. If you're an Instagrammer, you can find me there at the_professor_travel. I'm also on Twitter at TheProfessorTR1. And then if you're a blogger, you can find me on Blogspot at theprofessortravel.blogspot.com. Today, I am so proud and so very excited to introduce you to my special guest, my pops, our visiting professor, Maury Baskerville. How are you doing, Maury?
I'm good. How about yourself, Scott?
Oh my gosh. It is such a pleasure to have you, you know, here and for me to be able to introduce my audience to you. Maury is one of the best people I know. I had an opportunity to work with him while I was in Maryland. Just a wonderful family man, a great individual, just a brilliant individual. Currently working on your doctorate. Fantastic, by the way. So congratulations on that. For the benefit of my students, can you talk to us a little bit about maybe a little bit in your educational background and some places that you've traveled before?
Sure. All right. So education, undergraduate from University of Virginia, my master's and graduate certificate in marketing from University of Phoenix. So we go back there together. Mm-hmm. And then also working on my doctorate right now at Widener University in higher education leadership. So travel, done a lot of domestic travel where I've driven cross country to lived in California, lived in Arizona, I'm born and raised in Virginia, lived in Maryland three times in my life. So a lot of travel there, but internationally, I've also traveled to Switzerland, traveled to France, to Germany, and also to Africa, being in South Africa and also Namibia, where my wife is from.
And you have some amazing pictures from there I want to share sometime. Yes. I love that. Yes. But the focus of this specific vlog and podcast is going to be on the state of Maryland, where I had the opportunity to meet you, your wonderful wife, and I had an opportunity to work with you for quite some time. So let's start a little bit by talking about the history and what you know of Maryland. Talk to us a little bit about what you know prior to 1950 in terms of history of the state of Maryland.
Sure. Most people are kind of skeptical when it comes to Maryland because Maryland was a slave state. It did not succeed from the Union, though. So when it was the Civil War, Maryland stayed with the Union because we had people on both sides that really felt that they could go either way. The Mason-Dixon line is right above Maryland going into Pennsylvania. So that's one thing that you'll learn about the state of Maryland is it's always been about farming, but now it's more about urban. But that was the state up until about 1860 through 1950s. It went through Reconstruction, but it also went through Jim Crow. So there were still some unfortunate situations that happened for African Americans, for people of color. But at the same time, it has not been as bad as the South. So I'll just leave it there. Recent history from 1950s on, it did go through segregation. It did go through some parts of racial injustice, and also a few different times where there were some riots, especially lately in 2015 with the Freddie Gray riots that most people heard about. Yeah. Baltimore burned. So, and it was pretty scary here for a while because you never know exactly what was going to happen each night. So luckily for me, I live in Laurel, which is more towards right in the middle of Maryland. So it's 30 minutes away from Baltimore, 30 minutes away from DC. Yeah. But at the same time, what you'll see is that we are great people who live in Maryland. I would say that you're safe here, but at the same time, it's all about making sure that you know where you're safe, because there are some unsafe places, which we'll talk about a little bit later.
And I appreciate that. And by the way, when I was living out there, I had the opportunity to stay with you. I had the opportunity to, you know, break bread with you and your family. You were just such an amazing host, and I want to just highlight that. So there are some wonderful people in the state of Maryland. I had an opportunity to be on a bowling league in Maryland, and so there was a lot of great camaraderie. I got a chance to meet some great people there. It's just such a wonderful and warming and hospitable place, and that I can't highlight that enough.
Exactly.
So let's talk about the geography of the area. I mean, most of the places that I'm familiar with are really on a straight line, because we worked in Columbia, Maryland. That's where I actually lived for a while. And then I go about 20, 20 miles north, I hit DC, and 20 miles south, I hit Baltimore. But Maryland's backwards. A pretty vast place.
You said that backwards.
Oh, I'm sorry. South. The reverse. Yeah. Sorry. So, see, that lets you know it's been about 10 years since I've been there. So.
I get it. Not a problem. I want to make sure the viewers are not saying that we're crazy here. Exactly. Yep.
But talk to me a little bit about your general knowledge of the geography of Maryland, because there's a lot of places around there.
Sure. Maryland is more east-west than it is north-south. So what you'll see is it's 100 miles that go up and north when you look at 95. If you're going east-west, it's more like 233 miles. So the problem that you run into is that it's compacted, but there are different parts of Maryland. You'll have most of the best parts are always going to be on the water. Annapolis, where the Navy is, that's where a lot of people who have money live. You also have people who live in Baltimore, where Baltimore is seen as the fourth most dangerous city. But when you're in the harbor, you don't feel that way. It's one Not of the loveliest places that you'll know that you'll ever see. Then you also have parts you'll see on the mountains out there. You have Big Bear Lake, which is a great population place for people to visit to just get a chance to get away. Then you also have the southern part of Maryland, which is really on the coast, where you'll see that down by Chesapeake Bay on the eastern shore. It mostly is shared with Delaware, so a lot of people go out and vacation out there on Ocean City, but most people actually do go on the Delaware side. But it's a lovely state. There's nothing to take away from it, but there are different parts that are a little bit sketchy, so which every state has.
Yeah, and I think it's really more about, you know, knowing, you know, just being aware of your general surroundings. It's like, for example, I live in Southern California. I live in Orange County, which is, for the most part, a very, very safe place. But, you know, still, if you're in the wrong place at the wrong time, at the wrong, you know, with the wrong circumstances, you know, anything can happen. And so
I hated traffic in California.
You still hate it, probably. But you know what? Some of the worst drivers I've ever met were in Maryland. So I'm just saying.
Yes, I would agree with that.
Now, this is the bane of my existence. Okay, so some of the most beautiful weather I have ever seen is in the state of Maryland, and some of the worst weather I've ever seen is in the state of Maryland. Yes. Talk to me about your perspective on this.
Sure. Now, born and raised in Virginia, it's pretty similar to Maryland, but Maryland is still colder than Virginia. So in the fall, lovely, 70 degrees from around August until October, which we're in right now, 70 degrees, lovely. Same weather that I had when I lived out in Santa Monica, 70 degrees year round. Mm. Lovely. You also see the leaves changing different colors. It's just so beautiful in the fall. Probably the best time for here. In the summer, downright hot. It gets up to 100, 105 degrees, and it is humid, so it is pretty hot. Not as humid as you'll see in Texas, but it does get hot here. In the winter,
let's talk about the winter.
It's not going to go as bad as Michigan. It's not going to get into the negative 15s, negative 30s, but it can get negative. We have had negative 5 degrees weather here, but mostly it's going to range in the 20s, maybe the 10s for the last few years, but you have ice, you have snow, you have terrible drivers because they think they know how to drive in it and they don't. So, it's always awesome when everything freezes over, because then you just have great picturesque looks and views, and then you can go and you can ice skate if you skate down in Baltimore, which a lot of people love to do.
I have a funny story I need to share with the audience, and this involves you. So I did not get a message, and I ended up driving to work one day. And so I'm in work and nobody's there. And I'm like, what's going on? I mean, it's not really snowing outside. It's like maybe a couple of snowflakes or whatever, and it's no big deal. And so the time for our normal work startup comes and goes. And I'm like, I wonder if there was an evacuation or something I wasn't aware of. So I called you and said, hey, Maury, what's going on? I mean, I just want to make sure I'm supposed to be here and we're not doing anything. And you're like, what are you doing there? You need to get home. I'm like, well, I only live 6 miles from the campus. They're like, no, you need to get home. It's going to start to flurry really bad in a couple of seconds. Just go home right now. I'm like, okay, well, I just want to check on my sanitary. You're like, no, go home. get safe. And I'm like, okay. So I get out to the parking lot and it's starting to snow a little bit more. And I get out of the parking lot and get onto whatever the main street was that we had at the time that took us towards where the mall was in Columbia. And from the time I left to the time I got home, it was over 2.5 hours of bumper to bumper traffic in constant snow. Streets were closed. I got stuck in on one. I got stuck in one intersection on black ice. It was a nightmare, which, by the way, is one of the things that prompted me to move to Arizona. I just let my students know that. So, but as I said, weather can be very extreme in the area. It could be, like you, as you mentioned, very beautiful. And there were points where I literally thought I was living in a Snow White, like the Snow White cartoon, because I would go out to my mail and, oh, there'd be a deer there and there'd be chipmunks and there'd be groundhogs and stuff like that. I'm like, what am I living in? This is the craziest thing I've ever seen. But yeah, the wildlife there looks, I mean, you got a lot of it, and you know, certainly during the wintertime, it gets a little crazy, especially with a lot of the deer. There's like an overpopulation with deer, it seems like.
There is, but they run away when deer season comes up pretty shortly here, so.
Yeah. All right, let's move on to culture, which is one of my favorite things. Out of curiosity, is there a predominant religion that is in your general area?
It's still definitely Christianity is the major religion, but I will say there is a large Jewish population with one of the largest JCCs, Jewish Community Centers, across the nation. So there's a huge Jewish population in Baltimore that really run the city, and they do a great job with making sure that they're connected with their people. They also connect the city, make sure that it is safe, because that's their biggest concern. So they mostly run the city when you think about Baltimore, when you think about the nice parts, especially the Owings Mills area where I work for Stevenson University. They also do a great job just making sure that the community is safe around those areas.
What about the art community? What is that like in the state of Maryland?
I would say that it's more more underground art. So you'll see a lot of people tagging different areas. But now with everything that happened with Freddie Gray since 2015, you're seeing a boom when it comes to art, where a lot of buildings that were either torn down or burned, if they haven't been replaced yet, there's a lot of art that has come up around those areas. Even places that they've rebuilt, they might have rebuilt a wall instead of rebuilding a building, where there could be art that can be shown. So there's a lot of visuals that are there, things that have come up for Freddie Gray, things that have come up for, fortunately, the Ravens, which we'll talk about sports, because that's mostly what really brings the city together is sports. So, but the art I would say just the way that you look at the city and the way that it was built for people who love good art, because the buildings and also just the way that when the lights go out, most buildings are still lit up with different colors, especially when it's Friday. They have Purple Fridays in Baltimore. So for
reflective of the Ravens, Sunday. Of course. Yep. Yeah, yep. Exactly. So. In terms of language, it's predominantly English there. There's not like a really like alternative dialect or anything like that in the state of Maryland. Yeah,
there's small places, little Italy, little China, but not really that predominant. I mean, you'll see little small streets that are taken up, and that's predominantly where people who are of that origin really live and where they populate. So,
okay. And then of course, my favorite subject, diet and food, crab, crab, crab. Everywhere.
Oh, yes. Crab cakes and crab. Blue crabs are everything in Maryland, so.
It's just one of those things that when you go to there, you have to try it. You have to do it. Even if you're not really a seafood person, I mean, it's just something about it. It's fantastic. And I hope you don't take it for granted, because I don't get an opportunity to get out here.
I do. I do take it for granted now. I don't eat because I don't like cracking crabs, so that's my problem. I love crab cakes, though. My favorite place for crab cakes is Timbuktu. It's in Ellicott. Not Ellicott City, but, Elkton. Okay. That's where it is. So it's not in Baltimore. It's outside of Baltimore, and you have to go about 15 miles to get it, but it's worth it. Timbuktu Restaurant. It's awesome. Best crab cakes I've ever had.
And by the way, you make a very mean brat, by the way. I just want to let you know that, too.
Pretty good. I will say it's the grill.
It's the grill. But, I mean, there are some, just so we had a conversation about this in terms of restaurants as well. In the Bay Area, there are some amazing, like, one of the places we went to while I was out there is a really wonderful Brazilian steakhouse called Fogo de Chao, which is a franchise, and there are some in a variety of cities, but if you like Brazilian barbecue, it's probably one of the best I've ever had. It's fantastic.
Exactly. And there's some great independent places as well. You'll see some great seafood spots that are not franchised down by the pier. So down by the Inner Harbor. So there are some great places out there to eat. I'm surprised, though, you don't see as many outdoor restaurants right now. So
especially, well, especially considering the opportunities. I would think so. But do you think it has something that maybe to do with COVID or?
No, I'm just saying altogether. Most people, I'm talking about like outside vendors that would just be out there selling food. You never see it just because I think it's hard to get a permit down there at the harbor.
I know what you're talking about.
And especially because you have so many restaurants down there. It would be so great to have just independent people who are bringing their crabs that they've had and just frying them up or just doing food right there. But you don't really see that or oysters out there.
Yeah.
Most of everything is restaurants. So.
They may have a powerful lobby, which could be another thing too. So
they probably do.
So let's talk about sports. Now you mentioned the Ravens, but you also didn't mention the Orioles, which are right there in the city.
Yeah. Okay. So for your viewers, I'm living in the worst place for me to live. I am a Yankees and also a Steelers fan. So everybody in Baltimore hates my sports teams. So it's kind of hard for me to root for them because I hate them as well. So, but they have a great population. They are the birds. But when you beat one, you beat the other because it's killing two birds with one stone.
Oh, so
that's what I love to say every time.
Really? Wow. In terms of other recreation, I mean, obviously you can do a lot of things on the bay. You can go on boat rides and stuff like that are really awesome. Are there any like amusement parks or anything in the area?
Yes. Down in Southern Maryland, there is God, it's Batman rides. Man, why can't I think of it now?
Is it like a Six Flags?
Yes, Six Flags. Six Flags is right there in Southern Maryland, right on the right where Maryland meets DC.
Okay.
So Six Flags there. It's an older one, but it still does have some nice rides, nice family environment as well. Cheap, actually. We actually had a year's membership a year ago before everything hit for COVID. So. Mm.
Nice. And then finally, any state holidays or anything that is like pronounced?
Not really for state holidays, but I mean the Jewish holidays, because it's such a large Jewish population right for now. We're on Yom Kippur. So we're actually closed at my university. Most places are closed in Baltimore because it's hard to find people to work when it's a Jewish holiday because so many people are Jewish here in the area.
Yeah. So. No, that makes perfect sense. So let's talk about the population of the area. I mean, what is the population size of the state of Maryland, to the best of your knowledge?
It's about 6 million people. So with that, most of the people live in the city. So Baltimore is huge. But you have a lot of farmers still that live in the rural parts. You still have a lot of people that try and socially distance themselves before it was cool. People just want to live in the suburbs. They want to get away because they have money. But most of the people live in Baltimore when you think about the state of Maryland.
And would you say the second largest is probably Annapolis or?
Yes, definitely. Annapolis is second largest because that is where the nicest houses are. That's also where it's just beautiful views down there in Annapolis because that's also where the Navy is. So most people feel most secure down there.
Makes perfect sense. Okay, so in terms of the economy, now obviously some of the companies I may mention here, Marriott has one of its central locations or one of its central headquarters out there, Lockheed Martin, the Social Security Administration, Laureate International Universities, and of course, world famous Johns Hopkins, really huge employers within the area. There's another one that's out there that I didn't put on this list that you probably are aware of, but we can't really necessarily talk a lot about it.
Exactly. It's right down the street from me. A lot of people work for the government there. So we'll just leave it at that.
Yep, exactly. I think officially that government agency doesn't even exist. So
exactly. But most people don't realize that Johns Hopkins has two different areas. It's actually the hospital and then it's also the university. So my wife actually works for the university. So, but when you think about Johns Hopkins, it's everything in Maryland. So it connects everything and it brings so many people to this area and definitely smart people when you think about the university and also the hospital. So it brings a lot of different economic gains for the state of Maryland.
Excellent. In terms of travel and transportation, I was talking with you before the vlog and podcast here about some of the differences I saw in the way in which roads are maintained in, say, the state of Maryland versus the state of Virginia, which I would often travel between for work and for visiting. Talk to me about your knowledge about the infrastructure of the state of Maryland, some of the challenges that you've had to deal with.
Something you just made me think about that's also going to play a major part in that we didn't talk about earlier is that the roads for Maryland, especially 295, the Baltimore-Washington Parkway, is actually owned by Parks and Recreation from the U.S. Park industry. So that's more government than it is more federal than it is state. So there was a major problem 2-3 years ago where it was terrible. The roads were terrible. There were holes. There were potholes everywhere. And they said they didn't have the money to do it. And then the funny thing that happened is I think it was either the governor or one of the senator's wives was driving and hit it and messed up their car. 2 days later, they actually started working on it.
How about that?
It was taken care of pretty quickly. But because it's run by the park and recreation area, they have a lot more money to actually use for those things. So if there are problems with, say, for instance, with having to de-ice the roads, they do it a lot faster in Maryland than you'll see in other states just because of the traffic and also how many different agencies run through those areas through Maryland and also D.C.
Oh, yeah.
So then when you also talk about the infrastructure itself, we are a blue state, so not much to say there. I don't think that's going to change anytime soon. But our governor, I would say, has been one that actually has gone away from the presidency a lot with actually just trying to keep Maryland safe. And I will say that infrastructure has made us probably one of the safest areas to travel during COVID, just because we all get it. We all understand we're here for each other, and that's what Marylanders are really about. So that's the infrastructure I would really talk about when you talk about travel, because it's safe here.
And on top of that, you guys have one of the largest airports I'm familiar with. BWI is pretty sizable and international.
It's international as well. We'll not say that it's the size of Dallas because a lot of people fly out for international flights through Dallas. So you have Dallas, then you also have Reagan as well. So we have three within an hour of us. But BWI is definitely huge. It's definitely awesome. It takes you almost anywhere that you want to go as well.
I flew from Italy there. I mean, so mm-hmm. I know it definitely has some international ports.
It won't fly to Namibia, though.
It will not fly to Namibia. You're probably right on that. And then in terms of tourism in your area, why would a person want to come to the state of Maryland? Why would a person want to come to Maryland and make it their destination?
Right. So you definitely want to see the Inner Harbor. That's definitely the most the place that most tourists want to come to. You have the aquarium down there. You also have places where you can walk. You have just beautiful views. You have water. You also have crabs. So, I mean, it's just great places to eat. Then you would also look at Annapolis. That's also just as lovely, right on the water. Also great places to eat. Great to see the Navy if you're interested in the military, because that's where the Naval Academy is. Then you also have places, like if you're looking for somewhere to go in the go in the woods and also still be safe where you want to go. You want to go hiking. You want to go anywhere where you can just go camping. You can also go out to Big Bear Lake. So it's a nice area as well. But then you also have the Ocean City for the beaches. So it has everything that most people who like to vacation has already. But it's not all the way in the south where it gets too hot. So you'll actually still be around the water and not be consumed with heat where you feel overwhelmed.
And one of the other things that we were talking about earlier that I totally just forgot about until now was if you did want to find, like if you were going to take a cruise and you wanted to take a port that was not, like I live in Southern California, I'm very close to the port of Long Beach, I can go from there. But if I wanted to say, for example, go to the Caribbean or go to Bermuda or something like that, I could leave out of the port in Baltimore and be able to get to a lot of those places. So, I mean, there's a good advantage to being able to start from there. And it's a lot less expensive than, say, going out of New York City, for example, and porting from there. So there are some advantages, economically speaking, just being able to do that.
True. And train ports, just to go back to that a little bit, we also have Penn Station, which a lot of places have Penn Station. So there's a lot of places to take trains out to go all across. And then we also have the MTA system that will get you all around Baltimore, all around Maryland as well, all the way down into DC without needing a car if you wanted to do that as well.
In fact, I think probably on the East Coast is one of the best public transportation systems in general. Like here on the West Coast, we do have like a subway in Los Angeles, but nobody uses it.
Exactly. I was just like, I saw it. I was just like, what do people use that for?
I don't know. Everybody's got a car out here. So it's like, exactly. I know once upon a time.
That's why traffic is so terrible.
Thank you. So you alluded to it earlier. The government in the state of Maryland is a blue state. Although is your governor Republican or? Yes. He is. Yes. Okay. But everybody else is Democratic on the federal level.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Because I will say that it was weird that they actually elected him because most people were saying he had no chance. But he's just a person that's down to earth. He actually got out, met people, talked to people. I would say he does not go on pottery lines. He's been against a lot of times with everything that's gone on with the government. He's also spoken out against the president. So I think that people probably don't like him in his party, and I don't even know if he's going to run as a Republican next time, but that's the way he views himself. So,
and then is the state politics very similar as well? It's all blue as well?
Yes.
Okay, cool. Mm-hmm. Now, in terms of the resources, I know obviously crab and seafood are like a huge thing in the state of Maryland. Like what else is the state known for?
All right, so we're known for Francis Scott Key, who wrote the Star Spangled Banner. On a side note, which some people don't realize, I'm not trying to get too political in this, but he was a slave owner.
Yeah.
So because we were a slave state, people could own slaves then.
A lot of the founding fathers were slave owners. Exactly. In fact, most of them were. So.
Exactly. So, but it's also the home place, birthplace of Thurgood Marshall, also the birthplace of
Maya Angelou?
No, Raven. That's why they call the
Raven. Oh, Edgar Allan Poe. Thank you.
Yes. So that's what we're really known for. That's why you have the three Ravens people are Edgar Allan Poe, because it was his birthplace, and he actually has his own block right down from John Hopkins University, where they've actually immortalized him there. So that's a lot of things that we're known for are people like him. Of course, people know the Orioles from the Ripkins as well. But the state is really known for its seafood. It's just lovely. And also, I will say that Maryland has been the best place that I've lived. That's why I've lived here three times. The people are just awesome. And when we say we are Marylanders, it means us all, because we all stand together when it's something that's about Maryland.
Lovely. So let us talk then about how you guys got to be in that specific place, about being one state, one people. There have been a lot of civil rights challenges, and you've mentioned some of them earlier in this vlog and podcast. Talk to me about your knowledge of the area, and you know, don't hold back. Talk to me about it.
All right. So with it, I first moved to Maryland in 2002. So at that time period, everything was lovely. But to hear about some of the things that people have gone through, there were riots back in the 60s. There were a lot of people who were not allowed to live in different places. Maryland was one of the first places that had row homes, and it was not allowed for Black people to live there. So when they first were created, and then when Black people started moving in, white people started moving out. We've seen that all over the country, but most people don't know that about Maryland, because people always have gotten along in most cases. But then the major concern was, well, going back, first of all, also with the Civil War, Maryland is still classified as a Southern state, but it did not secede from the Union. It never left, because there were people that sided with both sides. But the state itself did not want to say that they wanted to be a Southern state, because they were so part of the Union. It was one of the first places. It was actually, if you look back at everything, Annapolis was one of the first ports. And Maryland was also one of the first capitals of the United States before everything got created, because we gave up land to actually create Washington, D.C. So with that, the state has always been it's always been about the United States. So it did not want to go against the United States. It didn't want that on the record. But then 2015 happened with Freddie Gray. That's when Baltimore burned. So, and you will see that there are three major parts of Baltimore. There is the beautiful part, which is the harbor. There's also the Jewish part, which encompasses most of Baltimore. Then you have the poor African-American part, which is what happened in Baltimore. That's where everything happened with Freddie Gray. There's a lot of policing because it is the fourth most dangerous city in the United States. But that's also because a lot of people there just have not been given opportunity. And that's on us. That's also on me. That's why I'm getting my doctorate in higher education leadership, because I want to make Maryland better for everyone. So we are seen as one people now, but at the same time, there's still some people that have not, do not and may never feel that way, just because of the way that they have been encompassed, because they have been pushed into one small area, and that's the area that burned. So when people call Baltimore an asshole, that's what they're talking about. And it's unfortunate because there's such lovely areas in Baltimore. It's only one small part. But I will say that after midnight, I would not want to be there. So, and I feel sorry for the people that live there, because that's where most of the crime happens. And it's unfortunate.
What kind of crime is predominant? Is it mostly, is it mostly drugs, or is it more along the lines of physical assaults and things like that?
It's drugs that lead to physical assault. So it's just a bad area that drugs have infested. It's also a lot of crime where there's murder. There's also, I've lived in Virginia where I saw it in Richmond. I've lived in California where I lived in Long Beach, but I never saw anything in Long Beach. So, I mean, I lived in Santa Monica, never saw anything there. So, I mean, I lived with homeless people that were loved there, but it's not the same in Baltimore. It's just not the same. People are looked down upon. People are looked at as, why are you here? And it's unfortunate.
Can I ask a question? And I know this isn't on the slide, but I mean, mm-hmm. because we're talking about civil rights, and because I am a person of privilege, I mean, whether I want to admit it or not, mm-hmm. I think a lot of people who are Caucasian don't want to admit that. How can we help? What can we do in order to support the cause and support awareness? Like, what can we do?
I would say, it's hard, because most people think that Black people hate white people right now. And if you say it to the wrong person, you will see that. I will say that people need to realize that racism exists in all races. So there's going to be Black racists, there are going to be white racists, there will be people that just hate each other just because of their color of their skin. So I would say the first thing you have to realize is that if you try and help, you might be asking the wrong person, and they will say, screw you. And that's not all Black people, just like racism is not about all white people. So I will say that you just have to just do what is right for each person that you come across, and not worry about that. But you also, people need to get back to family values, which is making sure that you're installing that in your family first. Not just worrying about what you're saying in front of other Black people, worry about what you're saying in your home in front of your kids.
Yeah.
Because that's the way that we change this, is by changing it in our homes, changing it in our neighborhoods, and then we can change the world. It starts with each one of us.
What about in terms of the ideas that go along with systemic racism, the underfunding of schools, especially in the Black communities, things like, I mean, I don't consider myself completely woke, but at least I'm aware of some things that are going on, and I want to be able to help support what I can, in order to make a difference.
I would say that we have become a very capitalistic society, though. So it's all about money, and it's all about saving your money and being about protecting your family, that we have gotten away from helping each other, helping our neighbors. So the problem is, when we see problems that are happening, that if it does not affect us, we usually want to shy away. And I will say, as a Black man, I have really never really had many racist situations. I've had a couple, but at the same time, it's not anywhere where I can say that I've been oppressed, or that I have been, that I've not been afforded the opportunity. I'm in a doctorate program.
Yeah.
So, I mean, but at the same time, I also realize there are so many Black people that will never have the opportunities that I've had, just because of my parents' upbringing, just because of people, the way that they view me. Some people have called me colorless, which sucks. So
that is such a weird statement. Why?
Because they say I'm not Black, because they say the way I talk, the way I carry myself, the way I interact with people, I will just say this, that I carry myself, and I will tell people this, that I am American. So, and that's the way I go as right now, because even on any type of application, I will not put race anymore. I will put American. Because if we can all come together as Americans, that's how we can finally actually just beat racism. Because then there's no way to really just put us out and just put us in these social constructs of race, gender. People don't even realize that gender is a social construct. These are ways that people actually wanted to separate people. So, and the thing about it is, it's not about race. It's more about power and it's more about money. So it's more about rich against poor than it is about race. So, and that's the way that you actually keep people down is by saying, hey, as a white man, you might be poor, but you're still white. So you're better than that person. Mm-hmm. So,
yeah, socioeconomic challenges. I apologize. Mm-hmm. But socioeconomics are one of the key challenges. When I teach cultural diversity, it's really something that people don't even, it's not even on their radar. And I'm like, well, mm-hmm. you may have unknowingly hoisted your opinions on other people without even thinking about it. And it's just such a really interesting conversation because that tends to open up their mind all of a sudden. They'll be like, wow, I never even thought about that. Because, you know, in a lot of cases, people are trying to keep up with the Joneses, or a lot of people are just living from paycheck to paycheck. And because they're trying to get that new thing, or they're always trying to get one leg up, when in fact they should be potentially living within their means and trying to do what they can in order to make life work for them and their family. So
sure. And if everybody did that for their family, we would have a much better society.
I didn't mean to go off on a tangent, by the way, but this was part of a great conversation I wanted to have with you.
Of course, this is about travel. This is about living. This is about knowing whenever you're traveling that you're gonna see different things that you might never have seen before in different areas. So, I mean, I went to Namibia, where my wife is from, and I saw some of the nicest areas. Swakopmund is lovely. Most people think of Africa, they think about asshole countries. So you don't think about how lovely different areas are. But then I also saw kombuchus, which are small businesses where people are just running. Then you also see people living in huts, living in tents. So you're going to see it all over the area. But I will say that this, most people say that we hate America. We don't hate America. We just hate that all Americans aren't viewed as American. That's what we hate. And if all Americans were that, we can then say that we're actually making America great, because it hasn't been great for everyone.
True. So thanks, Pops. I appreciate the education. So sure. Speaking of education, transition. So let's talk about the education in the state of Maryland. I mean, obviously you have a couple of major college locations, University of Maryland, broad and across the state. It's just huge. And then of course, world renowned John Hopkins, you know, not just for the college, but also for the medical location, like you were saying before too. Talk to me about the educational challenges that may come up in there, in the state of Maryland.
Now, there is a large illiterate population, unfortunately, in Baltimore. So, and they do use the No Child Left Behind Act in the wrong way, where they're just pushing people through, and people will graduate who have no idea how to read and write, and it's just unfortunate. So, but the educational system itself is pretty good. I will say that it depends on which area that you live, because there are some places that have great teachers, that have great opportunities. There are great charter schools in the state of Maryland. My son actually goes to one here in Laurel. So we have great educational systems here, but at the same time, there are some that are just overwhelmed. Baltimore City just has, I think it's 35-1 for the teacher to the student. And right now, with everything going on with COVID, they still have students that are not able to do things because they have a lack of computers. If you go on social media, you might have seen two kids outside of a Taco Bell actually getting internet here in Baltimore. So, I mean, it's that.
You got to work with what you got. Yeah,
exactly. Parents are trying to go where they can help their kids because they know that education is the way out. But at the same time, there are just so many different obstacles that are put in place for people that are poor. And that's the problem that we have is looking at how do we put more money into that education system instead of taking it out, because they think that people aren't using it. So that's the biggest concern that I see for students that are under 12th grade. For college, lovely opportunities. University of Maryland has a lot of different opportunities. John Hopkins, places like my university, Stevenson University, which students come to. It's a private school, but most people are looking for smaller class sizes, which I should have done for my undergraduate experience at University of Virginia. Didn't go as well as I wanted to. But at the same time, it's all about finding what really fits. There are a lot of different opportunities for students. There are School of Arts and the University of Baltimore. There are different options for everyone. So there's also trade schools out here too, if you want to just find a trade, if you don't think that education is the right for you. It's about finding what's best for you and your family.
And like you were saying earlier, and I totally spaced on this until just now, Annapolis. So if you're in the military, I mean, there's a huge opportunity there if you're in the Navy in order to be able to go to Annapolis. So
Exactly.
Great opportunity there. Well, what about safety and security? Like, we talked a little bit about the challenges in, you know, but I mean, I think that you kind of have that with a lot of cities. You know, if you're in the wrong place at the wrong time and the wrong circumstances, then yeah, there can be challenges. But in the daytime or even in the nighttime, it's, you know, if you're mindful of your surroundings and they're smart, you know, you can have a wonderful time and just about anywhere, I think. So
exactly. Black people know where they're safe. White people know where they're safe. So unfortunately, it is some areas that are very racist in Baltimore, especially when it's downtown Baltimore, especially late at night. You don't want to be caught there. So it's unfortunate. But at the same time, I will say outside of Baltimore, mostly go where you want, because most people are friendly. Most people will be there for you, will help you out. So I get the point where they talk about Baltimore, because there are some unsafe parts. It's classified as the fourth most dangerous city. So you can't sit here and say, oh, it's lovely when it's classified that way, because there are parts. But if you stay at the Inner Harbor, you stay on the west side of Baltimore, usually you're in that's going to be the nicest place. East side, north side, not so nice, unfortunately.
But there hasn't been any foreign terrorism threats or activity in the state of Maryland, to the best of my knowledge, at least.
No, but at the same time, because you have so many government agencies and one that's major there are always going to be threats that you'll never hear about, because they always squash them or they never bring it to light. But of course, when you just have so many agencies that are close, you never know what's really going on.
And then, of course, just as we were alluding to earlier, the issues with racism, you know, you have the stemming of the KKK in the area. Mm-hmm. That's always been a challenge. They're not out in force, though, on a fairly regular basis or anything
like
that.
Not anymore. I mean, there'll still be some rallies. There'll still be some things that you'll see. But I think Marylanders just realized that not many people are into that, so we don't worry about it. I will say it's bigger being from Virginia. There's still crosses everywhere in Virginia, especially in Southern Virginia, where I was born and raised. So you'll see where the populations are, and it's unfortunate that people still think that way, but hey, you can't change everyone. And that's why I say families, because if it's not taught, hate is taught. So if it's not taught in the family, eventually it goes away.
Wonderful. Well, I really appreciate you taking the time to meet with me and talk about the state of Maryland. I love it there. I think it's a great place to visit. In closing, really quick, what would you say, like one last little elevator speech in terms of why a person wants to come to Maryland? You know, talk to me about that, just on a blurb.
Well, for living in Maryland three times now, I left. I came there from college. I left, moved to California, then moved to New Jersey. I forgot about saying I lived in New Jersey as well.
Oh, there you go.
Forgot about that. And then coming back to Maryland, then going to Arizona to get my wife, and then coming back. There's always something about Maryland that's close to my heart. So, and it's the people. People in Maryland are just lovely to live with. I've lived in California, I lived in Arizona, I lived in New Jersey. There's no place like Maryland. Even home in Virginia, there's still no place like Maryland. It's just, you can be anywhere as quick as you want it to be in 30 minutes. Where I live in Laurel, I can be in Baltimore, I can be in DC. I can be around people that I love. I can be here and just walk out of my door and enjoy life. And that's what you see. Most people are just some of the most down home people that will just invite you in and just talk to you all day, because that's who we are. That's just what we are.
And thank you so much for that. I can attest to that, because you are one of the nicest people I know. And so I really appreciate you, again, taking time to speak with me and my students. That's just been such a wonderful opportunity. So thank you again, Maury. I really appreciate that. Now, for my students that are out there, if you have any questions or comments, please let me know. I'll be more than happy to either answer those or share them with Maury in case there's maybe a question about Maryland that wasn't covered. You can reach me at scott@theprofessortravel.com. If you're here on YouTube and you want to be notified when new videos go up, hit the bell icon right above us in order to be able to be notified of those. If you haven't already subscribed, please subscribe. It definitely does our channel a lot of good, and also will let you know when new things are coming out. If you like this video and you'd like to continue to receive content like this, please give us a like, and we really appreciate that. And then finally, if you're listening to this on a podcast such as Apple Podcasts or on Amazon Music, please feel free to listen and rate us. We really appreciate it. But until our next time, make every day a travel adventure. Thanks, everybody. Have a great day. Bye-bye now.